Okay, before I start my talk, I should probably say
thank you to our organizers on the physics aspect of the school. It seems to me that the choice, both the choice of the topics and the speakers, everything was excellent. Thank you. Thank you. David Gross. I thank you some next. I will thank you some next time. Okay. Oh. So you see, yesterday we dealt with the brains. So I showed you how supersymmetric Young-Mills theories can be treated exactly at strong coupling. And that's a new phenomenon for strongly coupled field theories to produce domain walls, which in their properties remind us of the string theory being in fact interpreted as brains. In general, the whole structure of my presentation is very kind of funny, I would say, because on one hand, we keep in mind that there is some at high energies, there is, instead of effective field theories, there are string theories with strings and brains. We don't know exactly what it is, but some elements of this construction are quite more or less determined, and they will definitely stay. And then this theory, we know for certain, it produces many things, but among those many are gauge theories, gauge Young-Mills supersymmetric theories. Now it turns out that they self-reproduce the same elements which are inherent to the high energy original theory, the same brain-like solitons. And today we will speak of strings, which also appears as vortex fluxes, solitons in Young-Mills theory. So the birth of the Young-Mills theory the birth of the vortex fluxes refers to early 1950s, and they were discovered by Abrikosov, a student of Landau, immediately when the Landau-Ginzburg effective theories emerged as predicting superconductivity or making the... So, what does it mean for Abrikosov string is a U1 string. I will show it a little bit more in more detail on the next transparency. So it is very well studied. There are huge number of experimental evidence about concerning the Abrikosov strings. In parallel with his strings, he also invented type 2 superconductivity. A nice point about it that Landau didn't like. He was Landau's student, and when he showed his draft to Landau, for some reason which I don't know, disliked him. And he banned, he sort of said, this is not to be published. So, of course, Abrikosov was very upset because this was one of his first work on which he worked very hard. He was not even a postdoc, a graduate student at that time. So he put it to the drawer and tried to forget about it. However, 2 or 3 years later, Landau changed his mind and he summoned Abrikosov and said that there is a change of heart. I think it's an okay paper. You can publish it. So it was published with about 3 years delay, and exactly 50 years after that, For this particular work, he was awarded with the Nobel Prize. So this structure, even scientific, everything in Soviet Union, in the Soviet Union was very rigid, and it was a pyramid with only from top to down. The orders could came from top to down, but no response in the opposite way. Then, in a sense, Landau, being a child of this system, also accepted this style of work in physics in his school. Okay, of course, in modern times, when gauge theories became was realized that gauge theories are the theories which run our world, people started thinking about how to generalize Abrikosov string in the case of non-abelian field theories. But these works started an honest generalization to relativistic abelian gauge theories. QED was done practically immediately. Here you see the names of the people who did it. It was in the 1970s, Nielsen and Dollison. But this still was the abelian U1 string. And in the 80s, many people worked on what they called non-abelian string, but these were not honest to God non-abelian string. I don't know, do I have any space to write something? Okay, I'll write it here. So what people do in the 1980s, they would take non-abelian field theory, not necessarily SUN, it may be a product of some SUNs with some Higgs fields, but the basic strategy was as follows. You take some non-abelian gauge field theory and A, and arrange the Higgs sector in such a way that eventually it is split, it is broken down to G tilde cross U1. And then in U1 factor, they just would repeat the Abrikosov Nielsen-Ollison construction. So basically, dynamically and factually, it was Abrikosov Nielsen-Ollison string, but obtained at some low energies in a more complicated non-abelian field theory. But all the structure of non-abelian field theory was totally irrelevant. Now here you see Abrikosov, young Abrikosov. Now a little bit about Meissner effect, which underlies Abrikosov Nielsen-Ollison string. You know that very well that if you have superconducting sample, here you see a white sphere which is made superconducting. So the temperature is very low and conducting sample becomes superconducting. Then what happens? Here you see on the left is T higher than TC. This is no superconductivity yet. And then there is an external magnetic field and the flux of the magnetic field, as you know, goes through. It can only form circles or go from minus infinity or plus infinity, or it can end on on magnets. There are no monopoles in nature, so the end each flux can end, let's say, begins on the at the north pole of some magnet, and ends and at the south pole of another magnet. Okay. Now it was observed by Walter Meissner that if you decrease the temperature below the critical, when superconductivity sets up, the magnetic field doesn't penetrate it. So the magnetic field doesn't penetrate it. It goes around, so the flux is still conserved. But of course, the energy of this configuration is higher because the length of the flux, because of the curvature here, becomes longer. So at the moment you switch on superconductivity, you increase the energy outside this superconducting sample. Now let's assume that the thickness of this flux is not so large, but the sample is very, very large. So like starting from here and to here. So you have a relatively narrow magnetic flux, which hits the sample. On the one side, there is this huge sample superconducting. What happens to it? As was known from the Meissner time, and I remind you, it's 1932, this discovery, Meissner effect. It is because, the magnetic flux cannot end just abruptly, okay? So it has to find a way from the North Pole, It has to find its way from the North Pole of one magnet here to the South Pole of another magnet here, but it cannot, if the poles are very far away and the sample is huge, normally in the empty space, what would happen? This magnetic field will go like a Coulomb field, right? It will spread all over it, inducing the force 1/r² or the potential 1/r, where r is the separation between the pole. But if it hits a very huge superconducting sample, the only way out to make it conserved, the flux, magnetic flux is conserved, the obvious way out to let it to bypass and go around the superconducting circles. It's a possibility, but if the sample is large enough, the loss of energy is very high. I mean, you have to pump an extra energy because the length of the flux becomes very large. So Abrikosov figured out that there is another way to solve the problem. Let's say you collect all magnetic lines into a thin tube, and it goes through the superconductor. Of course, when a magnetic flux goes in a tube inside the superconductor, inside these tubes, superconductivity have to be switched off. It suppresses superconductivity. The inner part of the tube becomes non-superconducting. But then it transmits the flux from one side to the other side. In fact, here in experiment, you see exactly this. You see a huge superconducting sample, and these dark spots, which you see here, are magnetic flux tubes, which go through. They have some regular geometry, but this is not important. Due to specific physics, the magnetic flux, which can go through one tube, is quantized. In certain units, it's 4 pi. If you want, if the magnetic flux is larger than 4 pi, several flux tubes will be formed, and the second kind of superconductivity predicted by Abrikosov, these magnetic tubes, they are not, they repel each other, so they form a regular lattice, and you can study just experimentally every tube separately. Sure.
In principle, the magnetic field is something external that I can choose to be whatever value I want.
Yeah.
But then you are saying that the magnetic flux inside the superconductor has to be quantized.
Yes.
So what happens with the extra? Like if I set a particular value.
Whatever little extras will have to go around. You still will lose. Because the string, the magnetic flux inside the string is always quantized. If the flux is large, it will split itself into integer times 4 pi. If there is some left over, it will have to go around. Okay. So now I will. Let's so now our idea was to make something else, to make from in supersymmetric field theory, to make a construction which at least distantly will remind us of the conjectured QCD flux tubes or strings which form about two probe very heavy quarks. And we know that in real world QCD, this phenomena does not happen. You see, there is no direction. You see, here it's basically one gauge field which forms the tube. Out of many gauge bosons in this group, most of them which reside in G tilde don't play a role. And only one gauge boson is responsible for the formation of the tube. In our real world QCD, we know that that's not the case, and all non-abelian gauge bosons play one and the same role. They are equal, and there is gauge boson democracy. They are equal in their rights, and all of them wants and achieves this equality through play, because they all play the same role. So we tried to invent a pattern, a scheme for the non-abelian gauge theory. As usually, we will start from the weak coupling regime, and then again using holomorphy and other tricks of supersymmetry, we will, of course, continue it to strong coupling. So this is probably the easiest example, which you see here. It's an SU2 gauge, it's a U2 gauge theory. You see here, we have SU2 non-abelian gauge boson, abelian gauge boson, coupling constant might be different. And then the Higgs sector, the kinetic term of the Higgs sector is d mu a. A is for the number of flavors. And again, we will consider SU2, although it's not necessary. I can consider any SUN or other groups. But for example, I pick SU2, and we have with two flavors, SU2 color and SU2 flavor symmetry. So each complex scalar field carries two indices. The first index denotes the color, the second index is the flavor. So the Higgs sector can be represented as a matrix field phi. It's a 2x2 matrix. Therefore, because we have SU2 and U1, the covariant derivative have abelian field and non-abelian field here. Now the kinetic term. You see, it's pretty unusual, I would say. First of all, it's rather rigid. And you see, these are the sum of the, this is because we take it from supersymmetric generalization. In supersymmetry, you cannot write arbitrary potential. You write the sum of the two D terms, non-abelian and abelian. This is the abelian, this is non-abelian D term, and this is abelian D term. This is the Fayet-Leopold term, which can appear only in the abelian subfactor, as I explained you before. Also, it, despite the fact this scalar field theory, scalar electrodynamics will be generalized and will become a supersymmetric field theory with extended supersymmetry. N equal two means eight supercharges. It's quite remarkable that this Fayet-Leopold term in this theory will not be renormalized in any order of perturbation theory. That's the consequence of this theory. The general statement that in supersymmetric theory, the D term can only be renormalized at one loop, but in our n equal two theory, because an equal two structure is even more restrictive, it's just a constant. And it's very well known in string theory that you cannot let this constant run. So, okay. Now I have to breathe a little bit because for a short while, for a minute or so, I will show you super generalization. Ah, no, that's not super generalization. Wait a minute, where is, here is super generalization. You see three line formula, okay? The one which we considered in the my previous slide was only kinetic terms. This was not considered. This is an extra field which plays very little role. It's a super partner to the second gluina. And this was our potential. This for SUN, so instead of two, I put here N. You see this is the D terms, the square of the D term for non-abelian factor, SU2, UC2, and this is the D term for the UN factor. Here I also a little bit even expanded. I added to the matter hyperfields mass term. It's called the twisted mass term because it's the only mass term which you can add and without ruining twisted in the quotation marks, of course, without ruining n equal to supersymmetry. Okay, now I go back. Now let us discuss the vacuum of this theory. Of course, being supersymmetric, even n equal to supersymmetric in the vacuum, the potential should be equal to zero. This term equal to zero and this term equal to zero. Now let's see whether or not we can achieve it. And the answer is trivial. Let's assume that in the vacuum, we have the vacuum expectation value of only diagonal terms. This is zero in the vacuum. This is zero, but these two are equal to each other. Then the matrix phi is the unit matrix. And then you say, or you can see it from here, because in this language, in the matrix language, it is trace of phi capital tau A over two phi capital. Okay, if phi capital is the unit matrix, it goes through tau A is the Pauli matrix. Of course, the unit matrix is commutative with the commutes with the Pauli matrices. So since it enters from both sides, you get the trace of the Pauli matrices. And the trace of the Pauli matrices is zero. So this is zero. And this can be adjusted to be zero if this phi 1 1 and phi 2 2 are in the vacuum are equal to each other and equal to the square root of psi. Okay. So the solution, the supersymmetric vacuum is easily achieved. As I said, it is easily achieved at weak coupling, but then we know that we started changing the parameters, moving towards the strong coupling, it stays there. Now we want to build something like a vortex flux or string, okay? What should we do? This is the vacuum structure, okay? We want to have the vacuum field at large distances. Here is a presumed flux tube or strings. This is a large circle around it. And they want that in the perpendicular plane outside the white, the large circle, this phi vacuum, this phi, the value of the phi field that approaches phi vacuum, but not just the phi vacuum, but a gauge transformed Fourier phi vacuum. So what you might do, you might multiply it by the phase e to the power I alpha, where alpha is the on the one hand is geometrical angle between, let's say, this line and this point and this point. It's the angle between two radii. On the other hand, it's identified with the phase of the in the space of the field phi in the space of fields. So here comes topology, right? Because if you achieve the following, if you go around the large circle, and of course the geometric angle changes by 2 pi. Also, because I put here e to the power I alpha, I change the phase of the field phi. And this, but this phase is fixed. If I change it also by 2 pi, this becomes a indestructible field configuration, which is topologically stable. You cannot deform it continuously to the trivial vacuum. Because if you start trying to deform it continuously, you will have to get singularity somewhere. And this singularity will make the energy of this field configuration infinite. The idea is the same as the Abrikosov's idea, but only now Abrikosov had only one complex field, which was scalar field, which represents the Cooper pair. We have a 2x2 matrix of the complex fields in SU2 gauge theory. Now, if I just rotate the scalar field and I calculate the configuration and then I the energy of the configuration and I integrate over the entire space, the energy will still be logarithmically divergent. So what's wrong? What I did wrong? It's again following Abrikosov, it's clear what I did wrong. You see, the kinetic term of the matter fields, it's not just covariant. If I forget about the gauge fields, then the kinetic terms contains just partial derivative. If I have a configuration of the field which rotates by infinity by an angle, then this kinetic term would also be logarithmically divergent, just on dimensional grounds. It will be dz, d2z, z is the coordinates in the perpendicular dimension, divided by z squared. But since it's a covariant derivative, you see, I can improve a situation by including also asymptotically A mu and A mu A, which are asymptotically gauge copies of the vacuum field. A in vacuum is equal zero to minimize everything. But I can now, this zero, I can now make asymptotic, I can make it a gauge copy of zero in such a way that D acting, D covariant acting on phi produces something which falls off at large distances. And the full kinetic term becomes therefore convergent at large distances, and the string tension becomes finite. And this is the standard thing, a little bit generalized to cover this case. So we do this. Now, of course, in order to realize the idea in the middle of the string, you have to phi, you have to put it equal to zero. So the boundary condition at infinity, phi and A are gauge equivalent to their vacuum configurations, but only with additional winding, which still keeps them gauge equivalent. And in the middle in the strings, superconductivity must be restored. So what is the restoration? No vacuum expectation values of the field phi, like in the Abrikosov language, no condensate of the Cooper pairs. And then the magnetic flux can go freely towards in the core of this string. This is what supports the string at short distances, because the magnetic flux stabilizes it at short distances. It doesn't let it to collapse into a singular line. Okay. Now the symmetry, oh, it's very important. You remember that the symmetry of the vacuum, okay, let me see here. Here, the vacuum has the unit matrix here, and the gauge symmetry, gauge SU2, SU2 acts from the left. Flavor SU2 acts from the right. Now, if we start, let's say we make the gauge transformation, only the gauge transformation, okay? This vacuum matrix of expectation value breaks, of course, the symmetry, because I multiply the unit matrix by, let's say, U from the left, I don't get the same matrix, I get something else. So the gauge symmetry is spontaneously broken. All gauge bosons are Higgs'd, they acquire masses. If I act by flavor symmetry from the right, it's also is spontaneously broken because I multiply by some other matrix U tilde from the right. Instead of the unit matrix, I get U tilde, which is different from the unit matrix. So both symmetries are spontaneously broken, okay? However, the symmetry, when I act here, I showed, I act from the right by the flavor matrix U. From the left, I act by U tilde, but for convenience, I write here U minus one, which doesn't matter because these two arbitrary matrices from SU2 Each of the two symmetries is individually broken. The theory is Higgs. However, if U tilde is equal to U and phi is the unit matrix, we still get upon acting by flavor and gauge symmetry, we still get the unit matrix. So this diagonal symmetry is unbroken. So what do we get? It's very well studied phenomenon in gauge theories. It's called color flavor locking. We have gauge symmetry, we have flavor symmetry. Each of them are individually broken, but there is a global subgroup, diagonal subgroup, which is unbroken. So what remains is, of course, it's the same. Here it's local U1 could have been. Here it's global, but what remains out of these two broken symmetry is diagonal SU2, which is unbroken. Diagonal means that you have to put U equal to U tilde. So in the vacuum, just a second, in the vacuum, after the Higgsing of the theory. So gauge bosons becomes heavy, their mass will depend on psi, on the Fayet-Leopoulos parametry and on the gauge couplings, but we still have a global symmetry SU2. Now let's assume, or rather I may say, but let's assume, now we are starting building our vortex flux or string solution in this vacuum with the global symmetry. Now we assume that in doing so, we break some part of SU2 on the string solution. Then SU2 global is spontaneously broken. And what happens? What happens with the spontaneous breaking? Let's be concrete, we will break SU2 global down to U1. We will have two Galstone particles which live only on the string. They don't propagate in the bulk, they stay on the string. So two new moduli or collective coordinates which are classically massless. Okay, now a few words, why such gauge configuration is different from the Abrikosov string and why it's topologically stable. In general, in the past, if you ask anybody, any person, are there string-like configuration? If you have the target space SU2, they will answer this is crazy because pi one of SU2 is trivial. Okay, what does it mean? If you have a contour, SU2 is a sphere, right? SU2 is a sphere. If you have a contour on a sphere, you can continuously uplifting it towards the south or north pole, you can continuously deform it to nothing. So there is no topologically stable string if you have just SU2. But remember, I have added also from the very beginning this U1 factor. Why have I to add it? Just to make a topologically stable string, which is different from the Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olesen string. So here you see SU2 sphere. And then in addition, we have U1. U1 is just a circle. So now let's see, we go over a large circle, on a large circle around the sphere. Here, we go around the sphere. Now, what is our trajectory in the target space? If you don't have this U1, you can draw only a circle on the sphere, it's topologically non-stable. But now if we add U1, note that U1 and SU2 have two common elements, the center of SU2. One and minus one simultaneously belong to U1 and to SU2, right? SU2 is the center group of SU2, has two elements, one and minus one. And U1 is e to the power I alpha. It also has the same one and minus one. So I can now construct my closed contour corresponding to the rotation around the string in the following way. I start from the North Pole, and then I move along SU2, okay, until I reach the South Pole. And I return back not via this SU2, but I switch here to U1. Okay, I switch here to U1. This is a topologically stable because I cannot now continuously deform the contour in the target space because there are two special points, one and minus one, from which it has necessarily to pass in order to start moving in SU2 and then turning to the right on U1. These are the only two common elements. So this contour is topologically stable, but if I do it twice, then it becomes unstable. For SU2 twice, but for SUN n times, which means that two strings, which I will build right now, if they are parallel and look in the same direction, they are equivalent to Abrikosov string. You see, non-abelian string disappear if I put them close to each other, and we return back to Abrikosov string. Or in SUN, you will have to put n strings of this new type, which are only Zn, which have Zn topological stability. Here you see this formula, P1 of SU2, pi 1 of SU2 cross U1 is Z2. Okay, now a little bit more about this phenomena. So what is the standard Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olesen string in case you have several scalar fields? In our case in particular, we can build also standard Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olesen string if we add this phase, rotation phase, as we go around the string as an overall factor. Then the fact that there are few flavors doesn't matter. They all are rotated in one and the same way. So in this way, you get the standard Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olesen string, but with a flux, which is larger, but because in Abrikosov-Nielsen-Olesen string, there is only one flavor which rotates. And so the flux is quantized to be 4 pi, magnetic flux is quantized to be 4 pi, and here with a few fields rotation, it will minimal flux will be 4 pi times the integer. However, now let us rotate, let us build a non-abelian string. Now we rotate not both elements. You see here both elements of the vacuum field, upper and down element, rotated in the same manner. Here we keep one fixed and we'll let rotate only one of two. So what generator we have to apply here? T3 from SU2 plus or minus a generator of U1. Generator of U1 is proportional to unity and T3 is proportional to the third Pauli matrix, okay? So when you add them, you get the rotation upwards. If you subtract, you get the rotation here. Now on the string, what happens with our global symmetry? Remember, it was SU2. If you do a no string, it's still SU2 because the overall rotation, you see, doesn't break this diagonal symmetry, SU2 global. However, when you do combine SU2 and U1, and rotate only one of the two elements, you see this matrix is no longer the unit matrix. It's a combination of sigma three and the unit matrix, right? With different coefficients. So the only generators of this global SU2 with which survive is one generator, T3. Because T3 commutes tau 3, the third sigma matrix will commute with itself and will commute with unity. The first and the second Pauli matrices do not commute. So SU2 global symmetry in the vacuum is broken down to U1. Okay. So the cassette theory, the theory on the string walled sheet, which originally and because of string, it's just a standard Nambu-Gatto descriptions. It has only two goldstones corresponding to translation of the string in one direction or a perpendicular direction or the other, is now supplemented. There are additional goldstones corresponding to the possibility now, possibility of rotate tau 3 inside SU2. So the cassette model which appears is the SU2 divided by U1. And this is a very well-known cassette model. It's the Heisenberg model in condensed matter or CP1 model in high energy physics, which has classically exactly two Goldstone particles corresponding to the number of broken generators. Now, if we calculate the tension of this string, this non-abelian string, you will see that in SU2, it's twice less than the tension of Bricossov string. In supersymmetric theory, these two, the ratio of two becomes exact. So indeed, if you take two non-abelian string and put it close to each other in the parallel direction, not anti-parallel, but parallel, then you will have a Bricossov string building it from two strings here. Now, as I said, the bulk theory can be supersymmetrized. I showed this terrible formula, which I don't expect you. It contains all possible terms in addition to the bosonic terms, all possible fermion term, which I even dropped, but even the bosonic part looks a little bit too much for me. But I only want to mention that there is a new term which I added in supersymmetrization, adding this mass term to the phi field. You see, when you take square of the second term, you can put to zero in the beginning, but if then this term is irrelevant, I remind you that the super partner to the second gluina. Then you will have phi squared m squared. It's the mass term for the bosonic field. It's the masses of the special kind. So n equal to supersymmetry is not broken. Now, let us go in this n equal to supersymmetry. What are the remarkable features? This is the bulk theory, which contains, I remind you, in SU2, you have three gluon fields plus one photon field, but this is abelian factor. We can ignore it at this stage. Its only role to to support topological stability. The coupling constant G1, the value of it is irrelevant. Now in the bulk theory, it's a SU2 gauge theory, and at large energies, we can ignore the fact that the gauge bosons are Higgs. At large energies is a normal gauge coupling constant, which grows towards lower energies. You see here this curve, it's a logarithmic fall off at larger energies. When you hit the energy the same as the mass of the Higgs gauge bosons, okay, at this point, the running law of the gauge boson in the bulk stops because the running, because you hit the mass of the gauge bosons below the mass of the gauge bosons don't appear in loops. So there is no longer asymptotic freedom below. Below the loop. But let's say you stay on the string. On the string, as we agreed with you, we have with you CP1. Original theory was 4D n equal to 8 Qs. This CP1, which we obtained, breaks 4 out of 8 supercharges, and the other 4 remains on the string walled sheet. CP1 with 4 supercharges is an honest to God n equal to CP two-dimensional field theory. Okay, so it has a Dirac, one Dirac fermion acting on the walled sheet and the complex bosonic field. Now it has its own running law of the gauge of the CP1 coupling, and being extended supersymmetry two dimensions, it runs only at one loop. And if you start measuring, if you now live below these energies, you go to the walled sheet of the string and continue measuring G squared in two dimensional theory, they match exactly with all their derivatives. So it's absolutely continuous continuation, which is of course a kind of exhibit some kind of 2D, 4D correspondence, which I hope to present by the end of my talk. So what lives on the string world sheet, two-dimensional world sheet theory repeats verbatim, you know, all the features of the four-dimensional Young-Mills theory in the bulk. Now, what is CP1? CP1 in the O3 representation means that at every point of the string wall sheet, there is a unit vector with the end point, which sweeps the two-dimensional sphere. And then they fluctuate in the quantum. The classical picture is, of course, all parallel lined unit vectors on the string world sheet. And this, if they are all parallel aligned, then this is the vacuum state because the vacuum energy of this configuration is zero. Now in the quantum, because CP1 is a non-trivial space, it's has spherical target space. Of course, they start to fluctuate quantum mechanically and is very well known in two dimensions. What happens, a mass gap is generated. And this is in agreement with the Coleman theory. What is a mass gap? Mass gap means mass gap means that You know what mass gap, that the particles acquire a mass, right, dynamically. And this mass is of order lambda. And this mass is of order lambda, but you see, because the gauge beta functions are the same, the lambda on the string in CP1 in the string is the same lambda, the same dynamical parameter, which is in the bulk. That's another manifestation of 2D, 4D duality. Okay. Now we do the next step. The next step, we know that in CP1 theory, even in supersymmetric theories, what happens? In CP1 supersymmetric theory, you have two distinct vacua. And their order parameter, much like Lachin-Young-Mills, at strong coupling, CP1 is a strongly coupled theory on the string world sheet, but it's known, its solution is known because of its two-dimensional nature. It develops the vacuum condensate of the fermion, by fermion vacuum condensate, which can be either plus lambda or minus lambda in SU2. So you have two distinct vacua labeled by this order parameter. And since they are energetically degenerate, and why they are degenerate at supersymmetric theory, each vacuum has to lie at zero, right? It is zero vacuum. They are degenerate, there can be the following configuration. This is the string, the theory on the whole string. In one part of this string, we have one vacuum with psi bar psi equal to lambda. On the other part of the string, we can have another, the second vacuum. And there is a transition domain between them. What is a transition domain in two-dimensional theory? It's a kink. We already know in lecture number one, we discussed a kink in a simpler theory. But in this theory, the situation is very much similar both to super Young-Mills and to this old kink. This kink appears to be BPS saturated, and its mass is again the difference between psi bar psi here and psi bar psi here. So the mass of this kink in this simple theory is 2 lambda. Okay. Now you can scratch your head and start thinking, what the hell does it mean? Because we do not just consider two-dimensional space and CP1 and two-dimension. This is an emergent construction. Our bulk theory was rather complicated, SU2 cross U1 Young-Mills with a special superpotential with the Fayet-Leopoulos term, and that's what we get. We get some kind of a flux tube with a magnetic field of this double. There are two types, the chromomagnetic third component and it fluctuates, and then U1 magnetic field. And now this is the theory on the domain on the flux tube world sheet, and it has this blob, which is a kink. But now let's go back to four dimensions and start looking what it means from the perspective of the four-dimensional theory. I started is 11:40, right? Or not? Right, I think, yeah, at 11:40. So I still have 15 minutes, but it's more than enough for me. So finally, with pride, we say, okay, we build this construction. We know what happens on its world sheet, but let us make a step back and look at this construction from the four-dimensional perspective. I claim, I will make a claim, and then I will prove that this claim is correct. But only before making this claim, I should remind you that in fact we have two parameters, the Fayette-Leopoulos term, which is a real parameter, and also we added the mass term. And the mass term is a complex parameter in supersymmetry because it's from superpotential. Well, not this one, okay, I'm sorry, but it's still a complex parameter. Now, in the picture before that, I considered the flux here. It's a weak coupling, well, I'm sorry. It's a strong coupling regime, you see. So fluctuations in the vacuum of these vectors is very large, and all mass formulas and whatever we obtained wasn't direct. But we can make this strong coupling regime easily. We can transform it into quasi-classical regime. Quasi-classical regime is depicted here. It's xi equal to zero, but delta m is not equal to zero. If xi equal to zero, then you have in four dimensions, when xi is equal to zero, you have the standard Hof-Polyakov monopole. It's the regime when you have the Hof-Polyakov monopole. So this is the Hof-Polyakov solution for the SU2 theory, and these are the magnetic fields, which emanates homogeneously in all directions. It spreads out over the entire space. Now you switch psi. In addition to delta m, you switch psi, assuming at first that this parameter psi, Fayette-Leopoulos term, is very small. Okay, you can move the other way around. You can keep psi and change m. M is holomorphic parameter. So when you change m, when you may have it first very much larger than psi, and you may decrease it, all these changes are described by analytic continuation. One is same equation. If you change psi, psi forces, non-vanishing psi forces, you remember the expression for the vacuum condensate of the matter fields was square root of psi. So when psi is equal to zero, there is no vacuum condensate. When psi is not equal to zero, the vacuum condensate start developing. And with the vacuum condensate starting developing, we have a magnetic flux starting being squeezed. You start with the no Cooper pairs, and then you switch off the Cooper pairs condensation in the Landau-Ginzburg description. So if they condense it even a little bit, there is a certain squeeze on the magnetic fields because it becomes energetically very inexpedient for the magnetic lines to spread all over the space. When the Cooper pair condensate is small, psi is not zero but small, the squeeze is weak. So your Hof-Polyakov monopole, if you look here picture in the center, it's almost like this Hof-Polyakov monopole, but far away, the distance which you have to achieve here is large distance. At large distances, you still have this condensate start squeezing a little bit the magnetic field flux, starting the formation of strings. But the monopole is very small, and the strings are very thick. And you have to go real far away in this, in the units of the monopole size. You have to really go far away from it in order to see the beginning of squeezing. Now we continue to change delta M analytically. What happens? We have one and the same formula for all four pictures. When delta M becomes smaller than psi over two, but still larger than lambda CP1, we still have a picture which is quasi-classical, okay? And the, but in this picture, the squeeze is already large. Very well-formed flux tubes appear from both sides of the monopole. You remember that magnetic charge of the monopole in certain units is 4 pi. So there are two magnetic fluxes outcoming to the right and to the left. Each of them carries 2 pi, one half of the magnetic field produced by the monopole. Okay, but still, this is in quasi-classical regime. If you continue further, if you tend delta M equal to zero and keep only psi, then you arrive to the picture, which is already entirely in at strong coupling. And then here you see a large blob of the side of the type of lambda 1 over lambda CP1 and the same lambda in the bulk dynamical scale. And the size of the these flux tubes are already I mean this size is determined by mass of by the mass of the W bosons in the Higgs regime. So mass of the W boson in the Higgs regime can be very large. So the strings are thin. They still carry out each of them of two pi of the magnetic flux. And the monopole is represented by this blob, which has nothing, seemingly nothing to do with the Tkhov-Polyakov monopole. In fact, that's the picture how Tkhov-Polyakov monopole is revealed in this model at strong coupling. And it turns out to be a confined monopole. You cannot isolate it from these tails because it has a magnetic flux emanating from it that it has to be carried through somewhat to infinities because the whole medium around is superconducting. So if, I'm just finishing. So if you don't have this picture where this parameter evolves adiabatically from free monopole all through this one, two intermediate phases into final space, I don't think there would be a way to figure out what's the interpretation of this CP1 model. And that this is the confined monopole. I go back here, you see this blob, it's a confined monopole in this picture. Oop. Now the last question, this is the example of 2D, 4D correspondence, which follows mostly, I mean, by construction, we wanted to appear to have, because this, you saw everything is in correspondence, lambda QCD, but here is the mass spectrum. In terms of this lambda, which is the same in the bulk and on the domain for, on the flux tube wall sheet, one and the same lambda, the parameters mu are of course different. Because on the wool sheet, we don't have this flat direction as we have in the gauge theory, which is parameterized by parameter U, gauge invariant parameter U introduced by Zyberg and Witten, but we do have this twisted mass. So a twisted mass has mass dimension M, and it also, there is another massive parameter is Xi, which is much, much larger. In fact, is arbitrarily large. But you see, first of all, it doesn't enter the formula. Second of all, if you here and on the world sheet, this parameter mu is mass, if you substitute it by phi, by u of the Zyberg-Witten, it's also a complex parameter. And the formula for the four-dimensional monopole mass at the appropriate point of the Coulomb branch on the Higgs, on the Zyberg-Witten curve is exactly the same. So again, if I close my eyes, if I agree to play with these two distinct parameters, one is two-dimensional, another is four-dimensional, I would not recognize whether things refers to two dimensions or to four dimensions. Full correspondence exists, of course, not every quantity, only BPS protected quantities, which can be calculated exactly, fully correspond, there is a full correspondence between four-dimensional Young's-Mills theory and two-dimensional CP1, n equal to CP1 on the string wool sheet. So this only confirms that this analytic continuation is more than appropriate. Okay, this is a symbolic picture of the correspondence. Here I draw a Dewar flask, and there inside is a very cold, let's say, liquid nitrogen. So let's say you are at a primitive school lab, and you cannot do the measurements inside because the temperature is very low there. But you can do the measurements on the outside surface, which is two-dimensional. And then in this, if we lived in the world described by this rather, well, it's a second cousin probably of QCD, not even the first cousin, but still it has the same base, non-abelian Young-Mills theory. Then if you measure this particular quantity we need at the surface of the flask without any measurement inside the flask, you would know the result inside the flask. Okay, I probably have about a few minutes. I'm finalizing. This is just a picture of how supersymmetric theories developed. This is roughly 1970s. Supersymmetry was born, and at first it grew very rapidly because, as usual, if you start growing from zero, whatever little fact you learn, it's a more than 100%, right? Now, at around in the late 70s, supersymmetry split into two branches, and then first, both of them were very green, and even this one was a little larger in size. This was phenomenological side of supersymmetry when people invented the minimal supersymmetric standard model, MSSM. And this was the theoretical branch. And first they went hand in hand together, each of them grew. Phenomenological side grew faster. As I said, during this, after in the 80s, the number of papers devoted to phenomenological supersymmetry and appeared in ArcSife exceeded 30,000 papers. So, and this continued on, because there are many parameters, you know, MSSM is a rather ugly problem, rather ugly model. It has more than 103 parameters, and you can always focus on the study of one particular parameter. You can conserve air parity, not conserve air parity, or air parity. So many, many freedom for young people to do the research. So 30,000 papers. I just dialed in supersymmetry, you know, I forgot, was it Google Scholar or whatever, and that gave me 30,000 papers. The number of purely theoretical papers was not so large at first, but it also grew with a culmination around 1994. This also was greenish, but then at around 2010, there was a drastic condition because phenomenological branch, of course, grew so fast in expectation of supersymmetry being discovered at LHC, Large Hadron Collider at CERN. And when it started operating, it very quickly they discovered the Higgs particle, the last element of the standard model, and then nothing. And moreover, by now, today, 11 years after this discovery of Higgs, there is not the slightest indication what is going that there is some no traces of supersymmetry seen. So, of course, any theory which pretends to be phenomenological cannot develop without input from the experimental data. 11 years of the complete absence of experimental data in this area, it led to the following effect. The larger part of this Fino branch, it's like in late fall, all green leaves became brown or yellow. And of course, the number of people working here decreased simply because there is no, you know, hint from God where to move further. You know, previously from Galileo, physics was organized in such a way that first there were hint from God in terms of the observable phenomena, then bright people came and built theories to explain this phenomena, obtained new predictions, and then tested them experimentally. And that's how the theory grew. Okay. Yeah, this is the last picture. So you see, now the situation with Fino is sort of sad, or people are in a dormant state or left this area and moved here. This situation in the theoretical physics, or even in theoretical physics, or theoretical mathematical physics, and now there is mathematical theoretical physics. All sorts of this is still continue to grow, not as fast as around in the mid-90s, but it still continue to grow. And I still have hopes that it will continue at least for some time further. And by that time, maybe here will be new branches. We will see. Okay, the last slide, also a picture. You see the tree of quantum science started around 1900s. And don't forget that even theoretical physics, which we talk about, occupies just one corner. Not even a huge corner, it's one corner of the quantum science. Of course, there are many interrelations between various branches. Here you see string theory, supergravity, string mathematics, swamp wool, but there is a huge physics going on here. Many branches already grew into huge applications, for instance, quantum chemistry, okay, or nuclear technology, or computing, even maybe quantum computing, but this gives you the scale of our relative importance in fundamental physics. Another picture, which it's a cover page of the CERN Courier in 1974. It presents the relation between experimental results and theory. You see, there is a small amount of experimental results, huge amount of theory here. But all these results are based on this small pile, and if it shrinks to zero, okay, you can imagine yourself then what will happen. Okay, thank you very much. I stop here.
So if you go back to these four blocks, where you had the small books, so
this one,
previous, yeah, this. So this is all in this color flavor block.
Yes.
Is it true that this is in the color flavor block phase?
Outside in the bulk, it's always color flavor locked SU2 gauge theory. And that's the reason, by the way, you see that we achieved what we wanted. This extra two modula, which you can call orientational, because they show you what's the orientation of the third color with respect to the first two. They mimic two, three gluon bosons, right? And you see when then you consider CP1 in quantum solution, it's not reduced to, I mean, the symmetry is not broken. The SU, full SU2 symmetry is restored, and CP1 starts from SU2. In quantum, in perturbative solution, what you get massless Goldstone, two Goldstone corresponding to SU2 divided by U1. But when you include quantum fluctuations, the original SU2 fully restored, and there is no specific direction which is singled out. Yes.
Let me try to phrase what I have in mind. So it seems to me that in this picture, really what you're having is a Higgs phase, which is only confining in the strict delta M going to zero limit. And you seem to approach that limit. If I were to compute the Wilson loop, like a proper order parameter for confinement, would I get it an area law in all the cases or only in the last one?
I forgot to say, you know, this is not yet the confinement of the type we expect in QCD, because you see what it's the matter fields of the original theory which are Higgs'd. So the matter fields are analogs of your Cooper pair in superconductivity. They develop vacuum expectation value. And the flux tube, which goes through the strings, is of that of the magnetic field. In QCD, we don't want that, or this is not enough, because you want the flux tube, which lets the flux go. This flux should be of chromoelectric type, not chromomagnetic. Okay, then it will confine heavy probe quarks, but our theory can only confine our model, or toy model, better to say, at this stage of its development, it can only confine heavy probe monopoles. And you see in which way? Not by one flux tube. If you have monopole and another monopole, they will be confined by two flux tubes. Each of them carry one half of the magnetic flux. So,
since the lunch will close, I propose to continue.
Okay.
Thank Misha.